Welcome to Our Community. Susie Thomas with you, visiting with Sherry McKinney-France and Angie Duck, both from the Starr County Jobs and Family Services. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
All right, tough topic, but one that we need to get into, and that is the fact that April is National Child Abuse Prevention Month. What kinds of things are we going to be seeing happen, taking place locally, that we'll be recognizing this month?
Well, we have a few things planned. First of all, this month in March, we sold about 400 t-shirts just to recognize Wear Blue to Work. And just wearing blue in April to acknowledge prevention of child abuse neglect.
Let me stop you right there. Okay. Let's go back to that Wear Blue. That's taking place April 13th, yes? How did that get started?
Actually, Starr County pioneered that event back in 2011.
Nationally, Starr County pioneered it.
Mm-hmm.
That's very cool.
Yep, that is really cool. So it's really neat to see stakeholders around the community and providers all wearing blue. If you're interested in wearing a blue t-shirt or just wearing blue in general, take a picture and post it to the Facebook accounts. We're also doing a selfie campaign, which will be promoted first Friday. So this Friday, April 1st, there will be a big push for that as well.
To wear blue on April 13th and post it everywhere.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right. That's taking place nationally, but we started it.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Love our community for those kinds of reasons.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to interrupt. Tell me what else is going on.
We also have a couple coloring contests going on throughout the community. So students and young kids are able to participate in that as well, just to acknowledge, you know, it's Child Abuse Awareness Month. You know, we also have posts that will be going out on our Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram accounts as well.
So, okay. Are there any dates we need to make sure we've got on the calendar?
Friday, April 1st, that's first Friday, downtown mm-hmm. Canton in the Arts District. There will be several agency representatives throughout the community downtown passing out pinwheels. Pinwheels represent the Abuse Awareness Month as well, so that people can come down, take a picture. You know, we can post it to our Facebook page. They can get a pinwheel and just kind of enjoy the festivities downtown.
Mm-hmm. And Angie, your position is what with Job and Family Services?
I am a training supervisor, so I train all the new social workers coming into the field.
And how about you, Sherry?
I'm the program administrator for the Children's Network.
And there are a number. Let's talk about the Children's Network. Remind us a little bit about that collaboration.
Sure. We are the Child Advocacy Center in the county. So when there are concerns of child sexual abuse, severe physical abuse, which to us usually means a hospitalization, children who are victims of human trafficking. Last year we had 7 Starr County children trafficked. We've already had 3 this year. And children who witness violence, and usually for us that means that it's children who have witnessed a homicide in their own home.
Mm.
Those are the children we obviously work hand in hand. I'm actually employed by Children's Services,
mm-hmm.
but as an organization, the network works hand in hand with Children's Services on a moment-by-moment basis.
Uh-huh.
They're
Job
one of our key
mm-hmm.
one of our key partners.
If we were to take the term child abuse, that seems to encompass a number of things. What exactly is it? How do we recognize it?
Abuse is defined as any kind of punishment that leaves marks, you know, that are widespread, varying stages of healing, severe physical abuse, shaken baby, you know, where there's a lot of bruising, a lot of brain damage. In that regard, you can also have emotional maltreatment where you have kids that are, you know, verbally abused in some way or threatened. So it's hard to see. You know, you have a lot of kids that come in that are injured. They have to be seen, you know, by emergency room, maybe have a full skeletal x-ray just to make sure that all their little bones are all, you know, healthy and growing and not in, you know, various stages of healing or have other traumas to them.
It's the law, isn't it? If we suspect a child is being abused or neglected in some way, we must report it. Mm-hmm. First of all, how do I know? What do I want to look for? And then who do I take that? What would be my next step? Who do I take that information to?
If you suspect any child abuse or neglect or emotional maltreatment or even sexual abuse, you can call our hotline at 330-455-KIDS, and KIDS stands for 5437.
Okay, but that would be KIDS.
Yes.
And say the numbers again, please.
330-455-5437.
Great. All right. We'll give that a couple of times. Again, what would some warning signs be?
I think some things can be like bruises, as Angie said, in various stages of healing, and bruises in places that don't make sense. You know, like kids bruise their shins all the time.
Right.
But like a bruise on a cheek or a bruise on a neck or areas of the body that make you think, well, gosh, I wonder how that happened. Or when a child or their caregiver gives an explanation of an injury that doesn't make sense. So I would just say use common sense. And if you suspect something is going on, I'm so glad that you said that, because suspect is the key word. You don't have to have proof. Don't take pictures. You don't need to, you know, just call. You know, we work with people who are experts, and that's what they do, is investigate abuse. And they're really good at it. So the average citizen doesn't have to do that on their own. They just have a moral obligation to report it.
It's very embarrassing, isn't it? I'm thinking the person who's calling there, you're afraid that you're wrongly suspecting a family, maybe a family you know, maybe a family member. I think, is it kept pretty confidential or completely confidential when someone calls in reporting something
like this? It is, but I'll say in the next breath, sometimes people figure it out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what we could promise you is one of our colleagues would never come to your house and say, Susie, I am here because your neighbor called me, John, and said, they would never, ever do that. But people, you know, can put, I mean, I can tell you if somebody reported me for child abuse, I can promise you I would find out who it was. And, you know, the people that we serve are similar. So might they figure it out? Sure. But it is hard to report it, especially when it's a family member.
Yes.
You know, you wonder what will happen. I think that there's a huge misnomer in our community that Children's Services is going to take the kids away. And we can promise you, if children are in foster care, it is because they were at imminent risk. I mean, like, going to die if they were left there. And there was nobody that we could find that loved them, that could care for them, that we felt could keep them safe.
The other thing about child abuse, one person's child abuse is another person's discipline. And the way they were disciplined as a child, that's the only thing they know to pass that on to the next generation. How do we break that cycle?
You hope to educate today's youth, you know, especially teen moms, to try to break that cycle, put in, you know, supports that maybe their parents didn't have at that time. Support is the key. You can usually tell how well a family's going to do by how many people are there behind them, pushing them along in their case planning. That's such a huge marker for success. And then it's very sad, because in some families that dysfunction plays out to the point where there is no support or appropriate supports. So the, you know, the county has to come in and through the courts gain custody of, you know, whatever children are involved in order to keep them safe, as Sherry shared.
What is the difference really between child abuse and neglect?
Huge difference. Neglect is what is done to a child. I'm sorry, abuse is what is done to a child, and neglect is the opposite. It's like the absence of. So the absence of food, clothing, shelter, nurturing, you know, going to school habitually in dirty clothing, habitually hungry. You know, everybody has a bad day, so we're not looking at one incident and not necessarily one bruise or one thing. But when you see a pattern of behavior, or a child that just doesn't seem to act what you would think would be normal, you know, that's when you call. But neglect and abuse are opposite ends of the spectrum, and both incredibly damaging. When I was a very young social worker at Children's Services, I thought abuse was the worst thing that could ever happen to a child. And it's not. It's a terrible thing, but neglect is equally as damaging. And sometimes it depends on the child, but sometimes even more so.
Do you find that most children that are in these kinds of situations are free to share, or are they protective of their parent or whoever might be abusing or neglecting them, a caregiver that might be neglecting them in some way, do they tell teachers? Do they tell friends? Do kids open up about it?
I think it depends. It depends on who that child can trust and what kind of an environment that they are in. A lot of times one child will speak out for the family, and yet the sibling doesn't want to talk. You know, some of the children that are involved are nonverbal. They're babies. They're not able to articulate that they're being abused or neglected. Or there might be some emotional issues there that they're not able to articulate that they're being, you know, abused or neglected. And like Sherry said, neglect can play, a very key part, because it can go on undetected for a long time before somebody in the community may notice and call our hotline to report it.
Mm-hmm. And our goal really is to help families.
Yeah. Yes.
I mean, to help when you ask, how do we end this? Well, really, we want to teach parents that there are other ways to discipline your child than abuse. And we work with lots and lots of community partners to help parents learn alternatives. You know, we provide services in their home, services in the community. So our goal is to stop the cycle.
I've read that occasionally there will be one child that's singled out, and that's the child that is abused. And then all of the other children will say, this doesn't happen in our family. We've never seen it. It's not happened to me. I can tell you, my mom and dad, they're wonderful. What do you do in that case? Can you talk about that a little bit?
That's a very difficult case to work with. It's not common, but it does happen. You really plug in the services, maybe put them through a trauma assessment and maybe have a trained clinician talk to that child about, things that they've been through in their past. A lot of times families will normalize a situation so that child doesn't identify it as abuse and neglect. They can also be seen at the CAC in Sherry's office and have a forensic interview if we believe that there's something going on, we're just not sure what. So there's a lot of different avenues we can take if we believe a child is being singled out and being abused in some way, and maybe the other children aren't.
Mm-hmm. We usually call that a target child.
What is that? What do you think causes that, or what do we know about that?
You know, we've had cases just since I've been at the network where the child maybe looks like they're the other parent, so if it's a mom raising the child, that child reminds the mom of the child's father, or their mannerisms, or parenting is hard. It's stressful.
Sure it is. That's right.
And so it's a personality conflict.
Wow.
It's a potty training issue. The other kids are already grown, and this is so it can be a lot of as Angie said, a lot of different reasons, but those are some that come to mind. Mm-hmm. But we do see that.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I've heard of it. It just seems like a very strange situation.
It doesn't make sense. Yeah.
No, you mentioned the term forensic interview. Mm-hmm. Can you remind us what that is and how those take place?
Sure.
Happens?
It's a non-leading, legally sound, neutral interview. And what that really means in English is we have a trained interviewer who meets with the child and just establishes rapport and ask just questions about life. Who lives in your house? Where do you go to school? Do you have any pets? What do you do for fun? And just tries to establish rapport with the child so that the child will feel comfortable and will share with the forensic interviewer if they have experienced abuse or neglect.
We're speaking with Sherry McKinney-France and Angie Duck. Angie's with Job and Family Services. And Sherry, you're with the Child and Adolescent Service Center?
The Children's Network.
Children's Network, I'm sorry.
Kind of, sort of, part of Children's Services.
Got it. Okay.
Yeah.
And a wonderful collaboration and doing some amazing work. We'll be back with more after these words. You're listening to Our Community.